when we're in the midst of a forest filled with snakes, cobras, vipers, leopards, panthers, tigers, wild boar, gigantic mad elephants, mosquitoes. And we try to enjoy in that forest. We may find some nice fruits. We may find some poisonous fruits. Certainly there is enjoyment, but at the same time, at any moment, things could change. And that is the comparison that Shukadeva Goswami gives in the Srimad Bhagavatam of this material world. And as was explained this morning, the real enjoyment that we're looking for could be found in this world if we have the proper attitude. If we see the facilities of creation as opportunities to serve, then this world is a place of liberation. But if we see this world as a place to control, to exploit, to enjoy without connection to God or to Krishna, that it is this forest of enjoyment. There will be enjoyment sometimes, but we don't know what will come next. And we were explaining how great souls see the potential in all of us to become spiritually perfect. And their ability to see that within us is actually our greatest qualification. Srila Prabhupada was asked, what was our qualification? To learn about Krishna and to learn about Sri Radharani, the very supreme abode of all devotion and love. To learn about Goloka Vrindavan, the highest realm of sweet love in the spiritual world. To learn about Lord Chaitanya, who is Krishna in the bhav, the love of Radha. To taste it and to distribute it. What was our qualification to receive it? Srila Prabhupada, with utmost humility and honesty, he answered. He said, you had no qualifications. And he's speaking to all of us. He said, I made your qualifications. How did he make our qualifications? Because he saw the potential within us. He didn't see us as being male or female or old or young or black or white or red or yellow or brown, or he didn't see us as being Christians or Hindus or atheists or agnostics or Christians or Jews. He didn't see us in any of these relative ways. He dealt with our relative conditions. He was very practical. We have to deal with the situation at hand and be relevant to a person's particular situation. Just like he spoke English to us. He didn't speak Bengali. Because we only knew English. He quoted Sanskrit, then he would tell us what it means. So we have to be very sensitive to be relevant to a person. But for what purpose? The Gita tells, Vidyabhanaya Sampane, Brahmani Kavi Hastini, Suni Chayva Swapakicha, Pandita Samadarshana. The real wisdom is to see everyone with equal vision. To see everyone is. Very dramatic effects, you're Everyone is part and parcel of Krishna. Everyone is a child of Krishna. Everyone inherently is a lover of Krishna. What we have forgotten. One time Srila Prabhupada was asked by some very challenging reporters, media reporters. They said, why have you come to our country? We have our own religion, we have our own culture. Why have you come? Srila Prabhupada answered, he said, I have simply come to teach you what you have forgotten. Anandamayo Vyasha. Everyone's looking for pleasure. The true pleasure at the heart. The soul is looking for is the pleasure of our eternal, ecstatic, infinite love for Krishna and to feel Krishna's infinite love for us. That is the origin of all pleasure. That is our potential, to be an instrument of that love in everything we do, everything we say. But we have forgotten. And in that forgetfulness, in the dream of illusion, we're trying to find happiness in so many ways. Endlessly being distracted. Srila Prabhupada gave us Krishna's holy names because he had realized the power of Krishna's names to open our hearts, to cleanse our minds, and to awaken the true potential of love within us. And because he saw that infinite hope that we had, he convinced us of that. That was our qualification. And that's what Srila Prabhupada wanted all of us to do for each other and for the world. To see that potential. However many layers of conditionings, however many layers of ego, however many layers of pious or sinful desires and attachments and aversions. Within, all of us is that potential. It's Krishna. I will tell you a couple stories about how Lord Chaitanya taught this principle. With your permission, Senior God Brother sitting before us. When Lord Chaitanya was in the South Indian tour, Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami, he tells us how Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he distributed ecstatic love of God like at no other time. He was simply giving it everywhere, to everyone. When he was in the Karnataka area, Maharashtra, between Maharashtra and Karnataka. There are two incidents that some of his biographers explain that are very, very interesting. One, he came to a temple. And this was a temple of very deviant, manipulative, evil people. And they had their temple, and they attracted people to come in the name of God and purity and religion, and their purpose was to exploit them. Especially young girls. They would convince these young girls to leave their homes, leave everything behind, and get married to the deity. Convince them that this is the ultimate perfection of life. That we are the representatives of the deity. And the deity has called you to marry them. So then they get married. They thought they did. And then they have, now if you do not listen to what we say, it is a great opera that you will suffer. And they had these young girls stealing. They had them engaged in prostitution. They had them engaged in plundering, in violent activities, sometimes even murderous activities. So these are the kind of people the anti-cult movement really did. Write a lot of articles about. But this was happening 500 years ago in South India. And first, do you like this story?
Rio.
Okay. I warned you. At first they were feeling really guilty, but they didn't know what else to do because they were abandoned. These people were, they were not their slaves. But as the years went by, all their guilt, all their shame completely was washed away. That's what happens when the heart gets hard. That even the cruelest, most evil, most malicious things, we don't even think there's anything wrong with it. Because that feeling of guilt is actually our own conscience, the conscience of our soul, the conscience of Paramatma. But when we repeatedly ignore it, we don't even hear it anymore. We don't even have a conscience. We can do anything and justify it without a second thought. That was their condition. Lord Chaitanya heard about them. And he went to the temple. These ladies were called the Muraris, because they were supposed to be the brides of God. So Lord Chaitanya was there. And Lord Chaitanya was a sannyasi, but he was extraordinarily beautiful. He had Srimati Radharani's complexion. And the great biographers explained his eyes were like full-blown lotus petals. His eyes were so big, and they were filled with so much love that they went almost to his ears in a lotus shape. His nose was like a fresh-blossomed sesame flower. And his lips were like a fresh bimba fruit. It was so beautiful. His complexion was radiant like molten gold. So these young girls, they had never ever seen anybody so beautiful as Lord Chaitanya. So they were looking at him, really with a desire to exploit and enjoy him. And Lord Chaitanya looked at them. He saw their spiritual potential. He saw that they were his own beloved children. They were Krishna's eternal loving servants. and seeing their lamentable condition, Lord Chaitanya started to cry. Everybody hated them. Here was this man looking at us with such love. Not selfish love to exploit us. Love because he really cares. He's crying because he sees our condition. When they saw Lord Chaitanya's tear-filled eyes gazing upon them with such affection, with such compassion, with such pity, something happened. Suddenly their hearts started to soften and they realized all the terrible things they were doing and they felt so guilty, so shameful. And they realized, here is the first person we ever met who really deeply cares. And they fell at his feet and begged him, please save us. Save us from all the atrocities, the sins and the karmas that we've done. And Lord Chaitanya said, I want to teach you how to be a real consort of Krishna. We're all ultimately prakriti. We're all Krishnas. We're all meant to love Krishna and be loved by Krishna. He gave them the holy names. He taught them how to live with character, with integrity. He gave them the courage, the strength, and the blessing to leave that place. And they became saints. They started going around and giving pure devotional service to everyone they met. How did that happen? The same principle as Srila Prabhupada in 22nd Avenue, or Frederick Street in Ashburn. Lord Chaitanya, he believed in what we could be. And he reminded us. And he cared. So Lord Chaitanya continued traveling a little further. And he heard about a gang of dacoits, thieves, robbers, and murderers, who cared nothing about life. They just cared about what they could get. It's really unbelievable. There are so many people like that in the world today. No conscience. It's just about me. When the ego, when we feed the ego and infatuate it, in this way, I and mine, nothing else really matters except how I can prosper and enjoy and control. I was recently with a very, very prominent person from Wall Street before the collapse. And he was telling me he was with some of the biggest, most influential people in Wall Street before that collapse. He interviewed them. He wrote a book about his interviews. It's shocking what they were saying. These people were billionaires. They were the CEOs, the presidents of massive investment companies. And they were saying, we don't care how many people suffer. We don't care what we do to the rest of the world. Business is business. We're here for ourselves. It's that consciousness that has caused all this economic strife all over the world. Greed, senseless, heartless egoism.
I'm the controller, I'm the proprietor, I'm the enjoyer. It doesn't matter. Life is meant to fulfill those purposes. And if there's some casualties all over the world to fulfill my purpose, that's business. Anyways, these men, they weren't wearing Wall Street clothes. They were dacoits. And the leader, the chief, his name was Nauroji. He was a very evil man, extremely powerful. He had a whole army of murderers and thieves with him. And they obeyed his every order. They would invade entire towns and plunder it, and wouldn't tolerate anyone standing in their way. And he had his headquarters in the forest. So Lord Chaitanya asked where he was. And people said, no, no, you don't want to go there. He said, no, no, I'm going. He said, no, don't go, you're sorry. He said, they will steal, they will take anything from anyone. Lord Chaitanya said, but I'm a Swami, what do I have to steal? He said, you don't know these people. They are so addicted to the smell of bloodshed, even if you don't have anything, they will kill. That's the way some people are. My beloved God sister, Yamuna Devi, who passed away last year. She was in 1971, in the month of end of November, December. Actually, I was living in Vrindavan at that time. And Srila Prabhupada was, the devotees were saying a sharavala, which was near the main road. And Srila Prabhupada was sometimes staying in his rooms in Radhadamadhartha. And sometimes she would go really early in the morning when Prabhupada was chanting his japa and translating. And she would go alone and sit outside his room. And he knew she was there, and he called her in. He said, how did you come? She said, I walked. He said, in the dark? She said, yes. Said these dacoits, they will kill anyone for a simple lota, water body. There are people like that. So Nauroji was like that to the extreme. So Lord Chaitanya went right into the heart of his community. And he sat under a tree. And the people, guards and his army, they all had weapons, swords, spears, axes. Who was this? They went actually to kill him. The Lord Chaitanya gazed at them with so much affection. It wouldn't, they didn't have the heart to hurt him. So they went and told their chief that there's a Swami here. So this, the chief was very upset. Who is it? There is no trespassing here. Why is he here? So he told his guards, bring him here to see me. He was very angry. They went to Lord Chaitanya and said, Nauroji is calling for you. Come. You must come. But by that time, Lord Chaitanya, his eyes were closed, and he was in the ecstasy of remembering Krishna and chanting Krishna's name. So he didn't hear them. But they don't know what is ecstasy or samadhi, so they thought he was ignoring. So they went back and he said, he refuses to come. He is ignoring your command. So he picked up a sword and a spear and came charging out, angry as fire. How dare this rascal Swami not obey my order? And at that time, Lord Chaitanya opened his eyes. And he looked at Nauroji,
with such affection. He wasn't seeing a murderer. He wasn't seeing a thief. He was seeing a pure soul, a part of Krishna, a lover. And he was also seeing all the egoism, greed, and lust, and arrogance that was covering that pure treasure of devotion. And he was gazing with so much affection and so much pity that the chief of the dacoits, he was completely disarmed emotionally. He didn't know what to do. Nobody ever looked at him like that. So he said to Lord Chaitanya, he challenged him, "What are you doing here? Why are you here? Do you know who I am?" "And why are you looking at me like this?" And Lord Gauranga replied, he said, "I see in your heart," he said, "I see that you have a treasure in your heart, and you've forgotten that treasure. And therefore you're running around trying to get this wealth and this power. And I see a treasure in your heart that all the world wants to have. And Naroji, what are you talking about? What are you saying?" Lord Chaitanya said, "I see in you a great devotee of Krishna." And Naroji said, "I'm the murderer and a thief. Don't you know that?" Lord Chaitanya said, "That's not important. You think you are, and others think you are, but in truth, I see that you are such a great devotee and lover of Krishna." Now, it wasn't just the words. It was the way he said. You see, to really give Krishna to others, we have to speak the right words. That's paripara. But to the degree we really care about somebody, we really feel compassion for somebody, to that degree, those words are going to have tremendous potency to transform that person's heart. And sometimes, you know, if we really care about people, we will strongly follow the regulative principles of Krishna consciousness. We will sincerely take shelter enthusiastically of chanting the holy names. We will really try to absorb the Srimad Bhagavatam. We'll really try to be good devotees, just so that we can actually have the power to make other people really happy with Krishna. What to speak of ourselves? So when Lord Chaitanya said, "You're a great devotee of Krishna," Naroji said, "Are you serious? Do you really mean that?" Chaitanya said with great conviction, he said, "Yes." Naroji put down his weapon, his spear and his sword and his axe. He said, "I've wasted my life in the illusion and the dream. I've done so many terrible things, but now you've awakened me. I want to follow you wherever you go." And then he turned to all of his army and he said, "You can get a new leader. I'm following this Swami wherever he goes." Or else you can take to the path of bhakti yoga.
So Lord Chaitanya,
explain to him the principles of how a Vaishnava lives. And then Lord Chaitanya is about to leave. And now Rodi said, I want to come with you. But Lord Chaitanya shook his head no. And now Rodi realized that he was still wearing gold and diamonds and rubies and emeralds and silks, all this, you know, different stuff that he stole from people. Because he was the chief. He was like a king living in the jungle. So he took it off, gave it all away, took all his clothes, ripped them up, and just put on an old piece of cotton for a kopan. And he said, now I no longer identify with my past life. I'm following you. The Lord Chaitanya didn't say anything. He just left. And he followed him. And he went with Lord Chaitanya. He saw Lord Chaitanya chanting and dancing and meeting so many people and transforming so many incredible experiences and miracles. Love. He went to holy places with Lord Chaitanya. And sometime later, he was an old man. I believe he was in his 60s when he met Lord Chaitanya. And he got sick on the journey. And he was dying. And as he was dying, Lord Chaitanya called him. And Lord Chaitanya took his head and put it on his own lap. And was petting his hair. And with tears of affection, chanting Krishna's names. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare. Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare.
And this person gave up his life, gazing upon the beautiful face of Shukra Ranga Mahaprabhu, hearing Mahaprabhu chanting the holy names on his lap. And attained the ultimate perfection of Goloka Vrindavan. What was his qualification? Lord Chaitanya saw that devotion to Krishna, and with his compassion and conviction, reminded him. When the Lord was going through Jarikanda Forest, he was with Balabhadra Bhattacharya, one assistant. They came on a path, and there was a full-grown Bengali tiger sleeping on the path. Now, for most of us, you don't wake a sleeping tiger. So Lord Chaitanya went right up to that tiger and put his foot on the tiger's head and kicked him. Very loving kick. And the tiger woke up and looked up, and there was Lord Chaitanya. Well, that's really the ego of a tiger. For somebody to kick them when they're sleeping. But Lord Chaitanya looked at that tiger with such affection. And Lord Chaitanya said, rise and chant Hari Hari. And what could the tiger do? Lord Chaitanya said it. He wasn't speaking to his tiger senses. He wasn't speaking to his tiger brain or mind or intelligence. He was speaking to the eternal soul, which is beyond any species. And the tiger was so much affected by that love, by that compassion, that he raised his paws, he got on his hind legs, and started chanting, Hari! This was not made for tigers, this microphone. Hari! from his eyes and all his hairs. The tigers have a lot of hairs, and we're all standing on end. He's in ecstasy. And Lord Chaitanya did the same thing to packs of wild elephants.
And then a beautiful story.
So many tigers were following on one side of him, so many deer on the other. And tigers and deer are natural enemies. For obvious reasons, tigers eat deers. So therefore, deers are 24 hours a day in fear of tigers. The fear of a deer. And tigers don't look at the deers and say, oh, they look so nice, he's innocent. You see them and they just see tasty food. Flesh and blood. That's all. So Lord Chaitanya saw that there were tigers following, deers following. And he turned around and told them all to chant, Hari Hari.
Hari Hari.
And they all started chanting, Hari Hari. And Lord Chaitanya awakened within them such a deep spiritual state when they chanted, Hari Hari. Each deer paired off with a tiger. And they danced together. And then each tiger and deer embraced. And according to Chaitanya Charitamrita, each tiger and deer kissed each other. Kissing was an expression of pure spiritual love, something that we can't imitate. But when Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu saw this, he smiled and he recited a verse from the Srimad Bhagavatam. How in the land of Vrindavan, because Krishna is residing with Sri Radha, Sri Balaram. Because everyone wants to please Krishna. Because everyone is attracted to Krishna. Everyone loves each other. There may be competition for the purpose of creating an intimate dynamics within the service of Krishna. But even the competition is steeped in deep respect, affection, everyone is a well-wisher of everyone. And the Bhagavatam tells even the ordinarily inimical animals of the forest are lovers when they're conscious of Krishna. So this is actually what it means to be Krishna conscious. Sometimes we have a very shallow conception that yes, I'm a Vaishnava. Yes, I am Krishna conscious. What it means to be Krishna conscious, what it means to be a Vaishnava, very exalted. Vrindavan Das Thakur explains that the highest position anyone could ever attain is the title Das, which means servant. Radhanath Das Thakur says, higher than conquering the world, higher than elevation to the upper planets, higher than all the eight mystic cities where we can perform miracles and live practically forever. Higher than liberation from all suffering, bondage, and dualities. It's Das. To serve from.
So Srila Prabhupada and Srila Prabhupada's assistants, they give, at the time of initiation, they give the word Das. And then our parents, when children are born, we give the name Das.
So does that mean that when we take initiation, or when we get this title, Das, servant of Krishna Das, Radhanath Dasi, Devi Dasi is the same? Does that mean we have attained the highest position, beyond liberation? Sometimes it doesn't feel that way. We still have the same struggles as everybody else.
Yeah, I'm a Das, I'm a Dasi.
What does that mean?
That means when Srila Prabhupada will give us initiation, when we get that title,
he's opening the doors to give us the chance to actually attain that.
But it takes sincere dedication, sincere surrender to the spirit of bhakti in every aspect of our life to actually realize it. What it means to be a lover of Krishna. To love means to serve. With no selfish motivation.
Our Mata Visakhi was asking about how she could make spiritual progress and balance her life and realize her potential. She said all this after she told us all that she's having a baby. Babies somewhere inside.
And
if you see a child as Krishna's child entrusted in your care and take serious responsibility on behalf of Krishna to nourish that child with Krishna's blessings and create a conducive environment for that child to physically, emotionally, and spiritually grow. That takes very unselfish service. The love of a mother is very unselfish. It may still be on the material platform, but it's a very unselfish service. Swamis, we observe. We try to keep a distance. And in class, everybody's enjoying, and the baby cries, and everyone looks at the mother like, "You're not supposed to be." Up and runs out. Sometimes all night, sometimes mothers tell me it's so hard to chant because sometimes my baby keeps me up all night long. Not to speak of, you know, when they're babies, they don't know how to use toilets or anything like that. They don't even know how to go out in the field and dig a hole in the ground. Animals do. They just do it. They're doing it for the mother. She's the sanitation department. Don't get paid. And very, very seldom does the father ever appreciate. The male ego, the female ego, it's like that. I can't tell you how many ladies, my husband just doesn't appreciate anything I do. I'm taking care of his children, I'm cooking, I'm taking, I talk to the husband, "Don't you care?" "Yes, of course I care." "Well, you really care?" "I care so much, I appreciate so much." "Do you ever tell her?" "Why should I tell her?"
No.
communication gaps. To speak of wars in the house, wars of the country, wars of the planets. So for being a mother on behalf of Radharani and Krishna, for their child, as a caretaker, we do it right. The more we have love of God, the more we can give our child. So that's a motivation force. You can't give what you don't have very well. I love my child. I want to liberate this child. So I have to take shelter of the holy name. I have to somehow or other moderate my anger and my emotions in such a way to give this child the best. I need to be listening to these classes so I have the right perspective. Otherwise, what can I give? To be a mother, to be a father, to render that selfless service for his spiritual interest as well as the physical and emotional interest of a child. The process will make us perfect. Because we're so motivated to access that grace within ourselves so that we can be an instrument. So the beautiful examples of Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who was actually playing the role of the devotee to teach us how to be devotees. These beautiful examples we cited this morning and this evening about Srila Prabhupada and other great acharyas. Acharya means to teach by example. We can't imitate, but they have these qualities. And if we just think, well, Prabhupada, that's Prabhupada. You know, we're just followers. Prabhupada's behaving like that to teach us how to behave. We can't imitate, but we have to follow in the footsteps. Mahajana Yena Gata Subhanga, that's the path of perfection. So to emulate the spirit, even in a small way, sometimes Prabhupada would tell us, just do as I am doing. 70 years old, starting an international movement with nothing, going around the world 12 times, writing all these Sanskrit translating. We can't do that. But the spirit of putting, of watering the root of the tree, pleasing Krishna, and knowing that the greatest thing that pleases Krishna is being an instrument of his grace to inspire others to connect with Krishna, to love Krishna. All of us can attain perfection if we just follow that spirit sincerely. Srila Prabhupada saw that hope, that possibility in all of us. And it can be realized. Maybe in a very small way, but it can be realized. That's the spirit we come together in beautiful holy places like Radhadesh, the presence of Sri Sri Radha Gopinath, association of devotees to chant the names of Krishna. Thank you very much.
Hare Krishna.
Would you like to speak something for me?
I have nothing to add. But perhaps I could ask you a question.
How do we really develop that mood of seeing the potential in everyone, instead of seeing the bodily designations? No, I'm asking you, Maurice. Well, let me ask you another question then. How do we actually keep our discernment? Because we do need to make choices in the world. And yet, how do we avoid being judgmental? Because in the material world, we think this is a saint and this is a dacoit. And sometimes we need to make those judgments, especially if we meet tigers. So how do we actually operate in the world, keep our discernment, and yet not be judgmental? Especially when we see sometimes there are so many problems, not just outside of ISKCON, but sometimes in ISKCON, and there may be a tendency for us to become judgmental on one hand, or on the other hand, we just don't see the problems and see everything is fine. So personally, I find this difficult to maintain proper discernment and not to become judgmental. I wonder if you could answer that for me.
You are so practical. Unless we apply teachings in a practical way, can never take place. Jnana vijnana tridharma. You need to explain there's theoretical knowledge and there's realized knowledge. And actually the only purpose of theoretical knowledge is self-realization. We have a map that shows us the way to Amsterdam. And we sit here looking at the map, studying the map, memorizing every road, every crossing, the terrain. And we tell everybody all about it. We'll just sit here. And what is the use? The whole purpose is to get us there. The whole purpose of all this is wisdom and knowledge, philosophy and logic, is to actually apply to our life. When we apply it to our life in a practical way, we grow in realization and wisdom. So wisdom really is how to apply theoretical knowledge in a favorable way that will bring about realization. And on one hand, we read about Lord Nityananda, he never discriminated. But at the same time, the whole purpose of philosophy is to teach us to discriminate. So where is the balance? Mahat sevam dvaram apurvam ukteistham advaram yoshittasam visangam. Srimad Bhagavatam tells us that when we associate with Mahats, saintly people, that association opens the doors to the perfection of liberation. And when we associate too intimately with people who are proud and envious and selfish, that association opens the doors to perpetual ignorance. So it's very important. And you see, where is that? In the teachings of Lord Kapiladeva, he describes devotional service in the mode of ignorance, devotional service in the mode of passion, devotional service in the mode of goodness, and transcendental. And in the purport, Srila Prabhupada, he cites Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, after explaining the qualities of each. A person who does devotional service, that means they're chanting Krishna's name. They may be doing puja for the deities of Krishna. But they're envious, they're arrogant, they're cruel. That's devotional service, you know what I mean? Emotional service and the more passion is what we really want out of it is prestige, position, power, profits. And Prabhupada tells us himself and quotes from the great acharyas that we should be very careful not to mix too intimately with devotees in the modes of passion and ignorance. The devotional service in the mode of goodness means we're doing it without attachment to anything. And transcendental devotional service means we're genuinely doing it because we want to please Krishna without our own ulterior motives. So as far as possible, when we understand the teachings, we are given a vision by which we can analyze. Rupa Goswami tells the symptoms of surrender. The first two are to accept what's favorable for devotional service and to reject what's unfavorable. So we have to be very intelligent this way. And we have to be very sincere. Sadhu Sangha, Sadhu Sangha, Sadhu Sangha. And Prabhupada explains, for devotees in the mode of passion and ignorance, we should offer all respects and obeisances to them, but we should keep a little distance. And we should really, really seek the association of those who inspire us in pure devotion. So it's not our position to disrespect anyone. It's not our position to judge anyone. But it is our position to evaluate what's actually favorable for ourselves. If somebody's criticizing others, somebody's finding enjoyment, fault finding, in politics, in various sinful activities, we can be a friend, we can offer respects to the devotees. There's a lot of marks on the moon, but still, the moon is there. They're devotees, so we can respect. But we're not going to gain much from that. We're going to gain and we're going to be empowered and we're going to, if we associate too much with that energy, it's going to bring us into that energy. So if we really want to help those people, even, and anyone else, we have to help ourselves first. Actually, the Prabhupada said, if you want to save people who are drowning, you have to learn how to swim. Good sentiments are actually good sentiments are realized when we're practical. So this morning Srila Prabhupada was writing about, you know, the way materialistic people do things. So obviously he's warning us against doing those things with materialistic people. But at the same time, he doesn't say we should hate them. We should understand that they're part and parcel of Krishna. Prabhupada said when you become spiritually advanced, you will love the soul in the tiger. You'll love the tiger, but you won't embrace the tiger. Because that will be the end. So discrimination is important, but it should not be judgmental discrimination. When a doctor sees, if you go to see a doctor, and the doctor says, you have malaria. And you say, why are you criticizing me?
criticizing.
Just want to give you the medicine so you get better.
So Srila Prabhupada would sometimes say people were rascals and everything, but he didn't say it out of hate, out of judgment. He was saying it to warn us not to fall into certain traps, looking out of compassion. You know, when a mother sees a child running in front of cars in the street playing with a ball, she'll say, "You rascal, why are you criticizing me?" I love you. Now I'm speechless. Does that answer your question?
Thank you.
Do you want to add anything?
Usually when great scholars ask a question, they already know the answer. Sign of their humility. Lord Chaitanya, Sanatana Goswami asked so many beautiful questions. Lord Chaitanya said, "You know better than me, but you're asking just for the welfare of everyone." Is there any other questions?
We can see that this Vishnu philosophy, is very beautiful. We can see that this philosophy, Vishnu philosophy, is very beautiful. It's surely the most beautiful philosophy in this world. And I'm wondering why we don't see a change in ourselves when we practice this philosophy.
But we all see so many changes in you. How many years have you been on the path of bhakti?
Almost 5 years.
Okay. So you just asked this nice question. 8 years ago, what questions were you asking?
Not the same. Not the same.
No, you can tell us. Maybe you should be telling us. Just the fact, before we come to the path of bhakti, most of us, our aspiration and our goal in life is very much to serve the ego, to serve the senses, to serve the ever-changing desires of the mind, yes, and to enjoy in so many different ways. And now, okay, we may not be paramahamsas, transcendental, but how we have changed. Now our aspiration is to become pure. Now our aspiration is to overcome these unwanted things. Now we're asking questions, how to realize this great teaching. So our change of values is a very, very major change in a person's consciousness. Now, to realize those values, to awaken that ecstatic love for Krishna, it may take some time. After all, we've been cultivating the ego for perhaps millions of births. And we've been cultivating the seed of devotion within this field of egoistic weeds that are growing to the sky for 5 years. Be a little patient. Rupa Goswami explains two symptoms of surrender, our enthusiasm to do the right thing, in bhakti, in patience. Because it takes time. It's like the doctor. He diagnoses you with malaria. And he gives you a pill.
Then 5 minutes later, he said, "Why do I still have a fever?"
He says, "You have to take the pill for the next 10 days.
And then 2 days later, "What's happening? Why? I still have a fever." This fever of material ego, it's been a chronic, inseparable part of our consciousness for so long. Ene chiva shadi maya nashiva rolagi harinamo maha mantra bow to me magi. Bhaktivinoda Thakur quotes Lord Chaitanya, that I have come with the medicine of the Holy Name that will cure you of all this material disease and distress and egoism and selfishness and suffering. But medicine, sometimes it takes time. You know, if you go to an Ayurvedic doctor, they'll usually give you medicine and they want you to take it for a couple of years because they're not just dealing with the symptoms. Symptomatic relief just kind of makes you, it kind of distracts your body away from the cause. It doesn't cure the disease usually, it just distracts you from the suffering of the symptom. That stuff can be somewhat instant, but to actually go to the root to cure it, that may take time. Yes? We require faith that it's the right physician. It's the right medical path. It's the right medicine. And then we take it with earnestness, with regulation, with dedication, with faith. And then we'll be cured. Manmana pampapat bhakto matya chinda namaskru mami vaishyashi shatyam ke prati jani priyoshine. Krishna says, always think of me. Become my devotee. Worship me and offer your homage to me. In this way, you will come to me without fail. This is my promise. Krishna is the absolute truth. But the absolute truth makes a promise. It's very serious. He says, without fail. Well, if we just earnestly, Prabhupada said, if we're sincere and serious, and we try to follow these simple instructions without ulterior motives, by Krishna's grace, ananyas chintayam tomam ye janapadu pashya, Krishna will reserve whatever we have and he will compensate what we lack. So just carry on with patience. Not something new. It's something that saints have been following, acharyas have been following, exhibiting, exemplifying, writing about since the beginning of time. Does that answer your question? We'll be enthusiastic to follow nicely, sincerely, and be patient. 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, 50 years. It's not much. In one moment he attained perfection because of his total sincerity. And we could do that. But sometimes it takes time to get that sincerity. Carry on, Prabhu. Everything will be alright. Krishna's there. Shall we have a kirtan?
Yes.
Thank you. dance like tigers and deers. Please, please, try to control your tendency to kiss each other.